Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I'm your host, Jason Turner, available for code reviews and on-site training. And I think you should, start by checking out the video description links here to look at t-shirts and Patreon and all the ways that you can help support this channel. And again, thank you for all of you who have supported the channel over the years. It is why this thing keeps going. In this episode, I want to talk to you about the idea of a simple function cache in C++, kind of like what we have here in Python in the functools library. Okay, so if you don't know anything about cache, basically, here's the simple example. It automatically looks up the cached result of a function call. And if you have a function call that, when always passed the exact same value parameters, is going to return back the exact same result, something like factorial, well, then it might make sense to do something like this. And I kind of just started hacking together something like this, and it looked kind of like this. So I've got some function that I want to call, and I'm being passed a set of parameters. That's pretty straightforward. Now, I need some way of storing and keying and looking up these parameters in the future. Now, I really don't want to store references here. I think that would be a bad plan. We don't want the possibility of storing references to objects that have gone out of scope or references to temporaries. That would be bad as well. So I'm intentionally removing all of the const volatile reference parameter things from these types so that I just have the set of types. Now I'm going to go ahead and intentionally create a copy of these. And now I need some thing to look up into to see if the set of parameters meets an already stored value. But I don't know what the result of actually calling this function is going to be yet. So I need to use another type trait. Now, I want to use the exact types that were passed into me in this case, because we might have overloads that are different. So I'm going to ask for the decal type of the params here. And hopefully this gives me the exact result type that I am looking for. And on this note, I am actually using auto here, not decal type auto, because the result is ultimately going to be stored in this map. And I'm again going to intentionally avoid storing reference types. So let's go ahead and do this. As long as we're doing this, we may as well make it as safe as we can, because we're already doing something that is a little weird in the C++ world. Okay, now we have a map that can store the cached values. And this is not ideal. Well, this is useless at the moment, because this map's going to get constructed every single time this function is called. So I'm going to make it static, which you should know, I really don't want to see a static value here. But it's an interesting experiment at the very least. If I actually found the value in my cached values, this key of parameter sets, then I'm just going to go ahead and return it. And what I'm trying really hard to do is to avoid actually invoking the function up to this point. But if the value hasn't been found, then I know that I need to actually invoke the function. And I'm going to do that with an insert into the map at the same time to avoid as many copies and whatever as possible. And I'll show you what that'll look like. This gets a little weird. Now, you know that I don't like seeing move in my code, or those of you who have taken any classes from me know that I don't like seeing move in my code, but there is actually a use case for it here. So I need to create a pair of the appropriate types, which for a map is actually a const of the param set followed by the result type. We want to avoid doing any kind of copies or anything like that again here. So it would probably be arguably good to actually use the cached values type to get out what its contained type is. So let's do that. And now I know that I'm going to avoid any accidental implicit conversions with all the implicit conversions that exist inside of standard pair. And I've done an explicit episode about that. Pair is a little bit heavy-handed. Okay, now to get back to that move that I was just discussing, I need to move the key in here. This is the last time that we have any use for it. And the second half of this value type is going to be the result of invoking the function that was passed to me. And this is where that decal type of the params came up earlier, because I'm going to for these params in now. I have made an explicit copy of them into the key, but I want to avoid any additional copies if I can, so I forward them into the function call. Now, I still need to actually return something from this function, and again, this is currently auto. I could have made its result type this as a trailing return type or something, but I've chosen not to. I need to return this. Now, what is being returned from an insert is a pair of iterator bool, and the iterator is the insert location, and the bool was whether or not it actually inserted a new value. And I could have used that insert in the first place, but again, I'm trying to avoid calling the function, if at all possible. So I think this is the best way to do this. So I need to, from that pair, get the first element, which is the iterator, and from that iterator, now I'm using the arrow operator, get the second element, which is the result of that function call. This all makes perfect sense, I'm sure. Let's go ahead and try to call this. Oh no, inconsistent deduction of return types. What did I get wrong? I was returning the pair here instead of just the value, the second half of the pair. It appears to do something, and it generated an awful lot of code, and we can't really tell if it did anything useful or not. Okay, did we get an appropriate answer? We did. We got 42. Plus I, which is 13, 55. But this hasn't actually gained us anything at all. Let's go ahead and take this to the next level and do a Fibonacci implementation. Okay, this returned a plausibly correct Fibonacci value, 233. This hasn't actually gained us anything yet. Well, it's kind of gained us something, because we can call this twice. And we know that the second call is going to be a cached result. Well, it should be a cached result. But we haven't really proven to ourselves that we've done anything interesting here, and we can't actually apply this automatically like we can in the Python context, because we don't have function decorators in C++. But the best thing that we could do is actually make a cached call embedded into our Fibonacci number here. Now, this is by far the worst way to actually call the Fibonacci sequence to generate it here. But we can play around with this and see if we have gained anything. by calling fib of a large value and see what Compiler Explorer does for us. Okay, so processing time exceeded. That shouldn't be shocking because we just did a very deep recursive function called depth. Let's go ahead and try the cached Fibonacci version and see that we can actually get, I think, the correct result. This is probably right around where we get an integer overflow with unsigned long. But that's integer overflow. That's not a problem with our caching algorithm. Yeah, there we go. At the 90th, we're no longer getting unsigned integer overflow. There you have it. It works. We can do something that was not possible, this naive implementation of a Fibonacci number lookup, by using a cached function thing that kind of works in a generic sense. You just have to pass it a function and a set of values, and you probably want to do something a little bit smarter, maybe use a different type of map here than I did. But I think that this is at least interesting enough to look at. I am not even going to pretend like this code is ready for production use, but maybe it inspires you on your project. So thank you for watching this episode of C++ Weekly. See you next week. Thank you.